This is how we used to program back in the day. People used to program a computer or a machine by punching holes into a piece of paper and feeding it into the computer. This is known as punch card programming. And this was one of the earliest methods of programming, but it actually wasn't that long ago. Punch card programming was used well into the 1980s, just a mere 45 years ago. And even if you've used punch cards to program before, it's still pretty insane to think that this method was essentially the birth of what we know as computer programming today. But also, researching how it was done and why it was done. For its time, this was an advanced piece of technology. The story of punch card programming is worth telling. And like any crazy but inspirational story, you have to start at the very beginning. How did computer programming actually begin? And believe it or not, the seeds of computer programming were sown in none other than the textile industry. Yes, punch card programming was inspired by the textile industry. But to keep things specific, the inspiration or muse was this. In 1801, Joseph Marie Jacquard revolutionized weaving with the invention of the Jacquard loom. Yes, a loom started this whole thing. At the time, textiles were woven on a loom. And I'm going to explain how looms in general work, mainly because it's fascinating. But also, when you understand how it works, you will realize that this is an early example of machine automation, which essentially is what a computer program does. And this was done in the early 1800s. To weave a fabric on a loom, threads are woven in two directions. A thread called a weft, which passes over and under a set of threads called a warp. This crisscrossing of threads forms the fabric, and the specific pattern actually depends on the way the wefts interlace with the warp. Before the Jacquard system, a weaver's assistant, known as a drawboy, had to manually raise and lower the warp threads to create patterns in the fabric. This was a slow, tedious process that required a lot of time. I imagine it wasn't very entertaining. Now, Jacquard introduced his machine, the Jacquard loom, and his loom introduced punch cards. This is how it worked. First, a designer draws or paints their pattern on a squared piece of paper, something like this. A card maker then converts this pattern onto punch cards row by row. For each unpainted square in the design, a hole is punched into the card, while for each painted square, no hole is punched. The punch cards, each representing a piece of the pattern, are then tied together and fed into the Jacquard mechanism on top of the loom. The card is inserted through a matrix of pins, and the pins pass through each of the punched holes and raise specific threads on the loom. Where there are no holes, the pins are blocked, and the corresponding thread stays down. As the shuttle moves across the loom, it weaves the fabric based on the instructions from the punched card. In layman's terms, this was a machine that could take a set of instructions that could be changed, i.e. programmed, and produce a corresponding output. And this was in 1804. This loom innovation essentially introduced an early form of automation. The widespread adoption of Jacquard's invention dramatically lowered the cost of producing intricate, fashionable fabrics. Such fabrics, which were once reserved for the wealthy, but now could be mass-produced, making them affordable to a much wider market. It also significantly reduced the need for human labor. Interestingly, this is a clear example of the impact automation has and continues to have even now. Once Jacquard's invention reached the public, the idea spread. The idea to use punch cards to automate machines or processes was invaluable, and it spread like wildfire. So we know the idea of a programmable machine being able to automate some processes was born in the early 1800s, and methods and discussions closely related to programming began to pop up. In 1832, Semen Korsakov, pronunciation, developed techniques for searching through information stored on punch cards, which he used for the Russian police ministry. Around the same time, English mathematician Charles Babbage was impressed by Jacquard's punch card system, and he proposed that similar cards could control computing machines. Although Babbage never actually turned this idea into a working device, by the late 19th century, punch cards were being used for everyday tasks, such as railway conductors using them to track passenger destinations, to libraries using punch cards to organize and catalog books. In the late 1880s, American engineer named Herman Hollerith was watching a train conductor punch tickets and had an idea. You see, Herman Hollerith was assisting the U.S. Census Bureau, the bureau that keeps track of all population data for the American citizens. The U.S. Census Bureau had taken 8 years to complete the 1880 census, and it was feared that the 1890 census would take even longer. So Hollerith knew that there was a problem that needed to be solved. They just could not take a decade to count the U.S. population. So he invented a machine that used punch cards to analyze census information for the 1890 count, significantly speeding up the process. The major breakthrough was the use of electricity to read, count, and sort punch cards, whose holes represented data gathered by census takers. Interestingly, Hollerith's punch cards were designed to be the same size as a US dollar bill at the time, making them easy to store and handle. His machines were used in the 1890 census and accomplished in 1 year what would have likely taken nearly 10 years of hand tabulating. So because of his success, in 1896, he founded the Tabulating Machine Company to apply his punch card system in other areas. In 1911, his company merged with three other companies to form the Computing Tabulating Recording Company. In 1924, this was finally renamed to the International Business Machine Corporation. And if that sounds familiar, it's a company that we know as IBM. There were many other similar companies, but IBM grew to really dominate the early data processing industry. And that's essentially the beginning of computer programming. But the next question is, how on earth did computer programming actually work? But before we do that, here's a quick word from today's sponsor. Today's video is brought to you by Surfshark VPN. Look, I'll admit it, I spend a lot of time online, probably more than I should. But that just means I've learned one thing: privacy is key. Now, if you're thinking that incognito mode has you covered, yeah, not really. Your ISP, public Wi-Fi, and even websites can still track what you're doing. So that's why I trust Surfshark VPN. With Surfshark, all my internet traffic is encrypted and routed through their secure servers, which means my online activity stays private, luckily. No snoopers, no tracking, just me and my screen. And here's a good part. If there is a movie or show that is geo-blocked where I am, or South African Netflix isn't doing it for me, Surfshark has over 3,200 servers in 100 plus countries to work around that. Netflix, Amazon Prime, I can just finally watch whatever I want. Plus, Surfshark doesn't keep any logs, so even they don't know what you're up to. And as a bonus, they block ads and malware, so you can browse without any random pop-ups or interruptions. It's smoother, safer browsing all around. And my favorite part, unlimited connections to one account. This means I can secure every device I've got, laptop, phone, tablet, plus share it with my family if they need it. No device counting, no swapping around, just full coverage. Right now, Surfshark has got a great deal through my link. 4 extra months free. Just go to surfshark.com/codingwithd and try it out. With their 30-day money-back guarantee, there's zero risk. Now, back to the video. So in 1911, IBM was created and punch cards were becoming popular. In 1937, IBM was churning out an astonishing 10 million blank punch cards a day. In the first half of the 20th century, these were just simple paper cards. They were designed to take a precise grid of punches, literally rectangular holes, consisting of 80 columns by 12 rows. And they were used in an enormous variety of business and government operations, from accounting records to personnel files. Before even getting to the punch cards, a programmer would write their code by hand on special coding sheets. These coding sheets were pre-formatted forms that helped organize the code. The reason for this was simple. There were no screens or keyboards back then, so everything had to be done manually on paper before transferring them into the punch cards. Popular programming languages at the time included COBOL, Fortran, and the assembly language. These languages were chosen because they were one of the first high-level programming languages that could be compiled into machine code for execution by a computer. Machine code is the code a computer thinks in. It's like the computer's own natural language. For simplicity's sake, machine code is binary. It's a bunch of ones and zeros. And that was an issue because it's just hard for humans to naturally understand that. And this is why early programming languages such as Fortran, COBOL, and assembly were used. It's a lot more easier to understand and grasp. Once a programmer had written out their code on the coding sheets, the next step was to convert the handwritten code into physical punch cards. This was done using a key punch machine, which was like a typewriter that could punch holes in the cards in specific positions. When writing a program, one card represented one line of code. So programs could have hundreds and even thousands of cards, making it a tedious task. After the punch cards were created, the cards were arranged in stacks, with the first being the boot card of some sort. This boot card was hopefully marked with a black or blue stripe, and this card had to go in first. It was just to ensure that the punch card reader understood how the data was arranged. And remember, every card represented one line of code, so every card needed to be in order. That is why position matters. If you dropped the cards, well, you were going to have a bad day because you would need to physically put them back in order. Once that was done, the next step was to feed them into the computer for execution. The cards were then loaded into a card reader, which is a device that could read the sequence of holes and convert them into machine-readable instructions. The card reader used electrical or optical sensors, and this could detect the presence or absence of a hole in each column of the card. These patterns were then translated into binary data, ones and zeros, which is machine code, which the computer could now understand and execute. I do have to note that there were apparently different models and different methods to read punch cards, but essentially the computer would read the punch cards one by one and in order. And the set of cards would contain both the instructions of what the computer should do, like adding numbers together, and data, values to be used in the calculations. And eventually the computer would read it and execute it. Which leads me to my next question. How do you read a punch card? All right, we're here. We're going to learn how to read a punch card. This is exciting. So this is what we have. We have a punch card. We have a EBCD table, which stands for Extended Binary Coded Decimal. Now, in very simple terms, this EBCD table was developed by IBM to interpret the punch card. It's almost like a key or a map. So, using this punch card as an example, the top of the line is a human readable code. It's a code that we understand, but the computer doesn't. So, our line of code is this. And remember that one punch card represents one line of code. So, a program at the time probably had a bunch of these. Now, this specific punch card contains part of a program which is written in Fortran. This is Fortran. And this top line represents the Fortran statement, which is Z1 is equal to Y plus U1. So this line of code looks like a simple mathematical equation, where the value of Z1 is being calculated as the sum of Y and U1. Now let's talk about the juicy part, the actual card. As I said before, the card has 80 columns and they are numbered across the top. And each column represents a single character, a character being a letter, a number, a symbol. Then you have 10 rows numbered vertically from 0 to 9. And these represent the positions where holes could be punched. You do get some cards which have rows labeled 12, 11, and 0 at the top to allow for special characters, but it's not illustrated in this example. There are two unmarked rows above. I don't know why it's unmarked, but these are your Y and your X rows. Feel free to educate me about this. Unfortunately, how to read punch cards isn't documented too well on the internet. I've only seen one blog post that does a really good job of this, and I'll link it in the description below. The black marks in this punch card represent the punched holes, and these indicate a specific character that is part of the original Fortran statement given. Now, this is a format of one type of punch cards. There are a few different punch cards out there, but this is how you read it. So looking at the top, that's our line of code. And let's start with the letter Z, or Z if you're American. To program Z, looking at column 7, we can see that row 0 and row 9 are punched. Now we look at our map. So we look at row 0 and row 9, look at where they intersect, and that represents Z, which corresponds to that line of code. So that's how the programmer would know it's Z, by looking at the punched holes and then referring to the map. Now let's do the next character of our line of code, which is an open bracket. This is in column 8. We have row Y, which is here, and it is confusingly unmarked, but that's how it is in the punch cards. Who am I to judge? We also have row 5 and row 8 that's punched. So we go back to our map. We look at Y and where 5-8 intersect, which is an open bracket. So it does seem that adding those unmarked X and Y rows allow for more special characters to be programmed on this card specifically. But again, I don't know why they are unmarked and not labeled. So now that we know the process, let's just do a random one. Let's do an equal sign on column 12. So we have nothing in X and Y, but we have both row 6 and row 8 punched. So let's go to our map one last time. And we know that 0, X and Y aren't punched. So we're looking at this row, which is represented by a negative or hyphen, and where it intersects with 6-8, and you get the equal sign. And that's how you read a punch card. So what happens is that each character of the code will have to be punched like this, and you can't make any mistakes because the computer will then read it incorrectly. And like I said, complicated applications would need stacks of these punch cards. But still, it's pretty cool knowing that this is how it was done. And there you have it, punch card programming, one of the earliest forms of computer programming. This is the start of it all. There are so many things that are fascinating with this specific part of programming history, and it just all started with this one guy one-upping the loom machine. Who would have thought? And then everyone thinking, hey, that's not a bad idea. We should apply this in other processes. But what really stands out, especially when you look back at the time, is how advanced this was for its era. Punch cards allowed people to automate machines, input data, process information in ways that were extraordinary. And I do feel like it doesn't get enough hype. And like I said, even if you do search for this online, there isn't as much documentation as you would hope for. I'm guessing because the era after this was the IT boom and the personal computer, which obviously stole the limelight. But still, I think punch card programming as a story worth telling, because it's incredible to think how far we've come in a space of 40 to 50 years ago since they were last used. But it's even more interesting to appreciate where it all began. Thank you so much for watching. As always, if you like my content, please like, comment, and subscribe. I'll see you on the next one.